There is one more very important topic which we need to look at, or like revisit, and this is the energy and the power flux of electromagnetic radiation. So we saw earlier, when we looked at the plane wave solution, we actually computed Poynting's vector. And if you recall, Poynting's vector gives us the power flux, or how much energy per unit time per unit area flows through a surface. So if we had the wave propagating and we had a surface in front of it, Poynting's vector gives us its magnitude, gives us up to the direction of the plane we're looking at, how much power flux we have. So how much, again, energy per time per area. And if we integrate Poynting's vector on a closed surface, we get the full power which is exiting or entering the surface. So the total energy per time which is exiting or entering. And what we got earlier on is that for a free wave, so for a plane wave, which were the sine or cosine waves, if we had them, we got that the Poynting vector is essentially a constant. So we got that it depends on the amplitude of the electric field or the amplitude of the magnetic field squared, but essentially the power density of the wave is a constant and the Poynting vector itself is a constant. Now, what happens if we integrate a constant vector over a closed surface is always that we get zero, because in half of the surface it will be pointing in one direction, but in the other half it will be pointing in the opposite. So in essence, for a plane wave, for a free wave, what we got is that as much energy is entering as it is exiting. And so a plane wave is never really decreasing in power. So the constant energy density and the constant Poynting vector tells us that the free electromagnetic waves, again, they're an idealism, they don't really exist, because they have the same power everywhere, they have the same energy everywhere. And so if we look at how much energy they're carrying throughout all of space, it's infinite. Essentially, they cannot exist because they would be carrying infinite energy total. And as we said, they're infinite in both space and time. So what happens if we look at the same thing? What happens if we look at the power flux, but this time of a more realistic wave? So let's consider a source of electromagnetic radiation, which is confined in space. So we can think of it as a point, a very small confined point, which is emitting radiation somehow. So if we look at the total energy being emitted, and if we want to compute the power flux, considering isotropic radiation, if we want to compute the power flux, some radial distance, say R from it, then the total power flux would be simply the total power divided by the surface. And since the surface area of a sphere is 4 pi r squared, we get that the power at r1 distance from the center is actually the power emitted divided by 4 pi r1 squared. Essentially, if we go further, if we go to a larger sphere, which is with a radius r2, for example, we have a reduction in the power flux because the same power is emitted, but this time it is spread over a larger surface. So We don't really win or lose any power. So the total power or the total energy is always the same. We have the same amount of power, but it's spread over a larger sphere. And so it has nothing to do for the power flux, but to reduce. And in fact, since the sphere surface is proportional to R squared, the reduction in power going further from the source is always going to be proportional to 1 over R squared. And so we see that we have quadratical decrease in power for these realistic waves, for waves which actually have confined sources, which are not infinite like the plane waves, like the sine waves. So this actually means that it's decreasing quite rapidly. So if we go twice as far, we get 4 times less power flux. And if we go 10 times as far, we get 100 times less, since 10 to the power of 2 is 100. And this tells us that our antenna is going to get lower power flux, and so it's going to get lower total power received the further we go from our emission, so from the source. Now, in a few sections, we're going to see how this will actually determine the free space losses. So we're going to see that this is actually what determines how the power of a signal is decreasing with space, and this is why antennas will need to be more directive the further we are from the source of the radiation. But essentially, the lesson learned is that real radiation decreases, and it actually decreases by the square of the distance, not simply linearly. A very nice example which we can look at, and it's very nice because it's one of the very few which can be solved exactly, is a dipole antenna. And we're going to look at this dipole antenna and compute from the formulas we got earlier about the far field. We're actually going to compute the power, and we're going to look at the distribution of the pointing vector. So the power flux, total power, and the distribution of the power flux in space. So a dipole antenna, as you may think, is actually an antenna which is simply a varying dipole. So we have an alternating current. We're considering the simplest case, simply sinusoidal radiation, so no information carried. So we're feeding this antenna, we have two poles, and we're feeding them, so the one is connected to the plus of our source, the other one to the minus, and we're feeding alternating voltage, which leads to alternating current, which in turn leads to alternating dipole moment. So if we had some initial dipole moment P0, the dipole moment as a function of time would be this initial moment times a cosine or a sine, depending on the phase we start with. So applying the formulas we got even up to a first order, the formulas we got for the far field, for this dipole antenna, we actually get the following formulas for the electric and for the magnetic fields. And you can note once again that we have a decrease in each of the two fields is 1 over r, so we have linear decrease as we go further. Now, this actually is what results in the quadratic decrease in power, since if you recall, the pointing vector is the vector product of these two, but up to a direction, it is their multiplication. And so, essentially, since each of them decreases linearly, the pointing vector will decrease quadratically, as we computed with the very simple argument of spreading the same power over a larger sphere. So this is actually a very nice representation of what the fields look like, and you can see that as we're going further and further, there again, all of the waves are essentially solutions to Maxwell's equations, as usual, and the fronts are getting flatter and flatter, so they approach the flat, perfect case of a flat wave or a sine wave, but they never really reach it, since the power is always dropping. Now, if we compute the average value of the pointing vector, and if we compute the pointing vector in general, we're going to see two very distinct things, two very important things. Now, first of all, we have very high dependence on the frequency. So we see omega by the power of 4, which means that higher frequency is going to give us higher power flux, and this dependency is very strong. We see the 1 over r square dependence, so we see that the power flux is decreasing radially, by the square of the radial distance, as is expected. But we also see a term which has this sign theta here, where theta is the angle between the axis of the antenna and the plane orthogonal to it, where theta is the axis between the direction of the antenna, so essentially the line which we had for the dipole antenna, and the point which we're looking at. And so we see that unlike the isotropic, the ideal isotropic radiator which we looked at, so unlike a point which emits spherical fronts isotropically in all directions in the same way, we actually have a dependence on direction here. And this sine function tells us that whenever we're looking exactly on the axis of the antenna, there is nothing there, so there is no power flux, since sine of zero is zero. On the other hand, if we're looking orthogonal to this axis, so if this is the axis of the antenna and we're looking orthogonal to it, so perpendicular to it, we get the maximum power possible. And this results, since we have a three-dimensional shape, the wavefront, this results in this toroidal shape which you see here. And this is exactly what we would have anticipated, since we have a dipole. And if you recall, a dipole had exactly this type of symmetry. But looking at it, we can see that some points, exactly the points at which our antenna points, in essence, they will get no power. So the points in which we have the axis of the antenna exactly pointing towards them, they will get nothing, whereas the points which are parallel, or orthogonal actually, so the points which are orthogonal to the direction of the antenna, are going to get the maximum power possible. And you may ask yourself, okay, but how is this, where is this additional power coming from? So the points which are orthogonal get more power, those who are parallel get no power at all. Well, the reason this happens is that power is redistributed. So the geometry of the antenna is such that power is distributed mostly on this equatorial region, as we may call it, on the torus. Whereas almost no power, and essentially no power, reaches the regions exactly where the antenna is pointing. So this tells us something very important. It actually teaches us that we can manipulate the multipoles, we can manipulate the fields themselves when emitting in such a way that we can get a very large power flux in a certain direction and a very low such in another one. So this is a general lesson which we're going to see in the next section, and this is actually how antennas work. This is the main logic behind them. So their idea is to focus the energy in the direction in which we need it by taking energy or by taking power from the other directions. So essentially, antennas, generally, they do not create or destroy energies. Nothing can do that. They simply redirect. And we're going to learn soon how exactly to do that and how this is achieved and how it allows us to reach much further with the same energy being fed, simply because we're focusing it. But one other very important lesson which we get from all of this is that the further we are from the source, the more flat the front looks. So you can see in this animation that very far, very, very far from the source, we have those toroidal fronts, but even if we had spherical fronts, very, very far from the source, we actually get them to be almost flat. And for a small range of distances, very far from the source, we can approximate the wave as being free. And this is actually the idea that we may think we get by antennas. So looking at an antenna, we can analyze the far field as being the point at which the fronts are approximately flat. So by analyzing how the fields behave in the near field, we can get a general idea of the far field, and then we can approximate the far field as almost a flat front in the distance in which we need it. So we can take into account the reduction in power from the equations themselves, but essentially once we know how much the power would have dropped, we can approximate the field as being almost flat, and we can use this approximation for our receiving antenna, which will see the field almost as being a flat wave. And last but not least, the general idea that we need to remember from all of this is that real electromagnetic waves, they are not isotropically radiated. So there is no isotropic radiator which emits the same power everywhere. What is more important is that they are dropping in power. So real electromagnetic waves, they lose power flux. The further we go, the less power we're going to get with the same antenna. And so the link between two antennas is highly dependent on the distance between them. So the same antennas, the same quality of antennas, will get progressively worse quality of signal the further we go, since the signal power is going to go lower and lower. And what we saw is the very important idea that directivity, or that how much power we get for a certain direction, is determined by the properties of the antennas, and it is essentially what we will manipulate and what we will need to get our antennas to be useful for a specific direction, and to get our antennas to deliver the required power flux in the given point, even if we feed it with less power than an isotropic radiator would require.